Hey there, welcome to another episode of the Sage Mindset Podcast. I'm your host, Kyle Gillette, and the owner of Gillette Solutions, along with the creator of the Sage Mindset Framework. So I want to introduce you to Hurley Fox. He's a business consultant and bookkeeper with an education background who loves making the lives of business owners easier. He enjoys conversations with passionate people, and he enjoys to learn and grab a hold of everything and anything that he can, which means that's exactly how he takes care of his clients. So welcome, Hurley, to the show. Thank you for being here. All right, everybody. Well, welcome again to another episode of the Sage Mindset Podcast. And like I said, I've got Hurley Fox with us here, and I'm really excited to hear about his business experiences, his wisdom and insights he's going to share with you. So welcome to the show, Hurley.
Thanks so much for having me, Kyle. It's a pleasure to be here.
Awesome. Yeah. So, okay. One of my favorite things, and I say this on like every podcast because it's true, is I love to hear origin stories. So if you could share with us, you know, what inspired you to start your business? What's that story behind how you got to where you are today?
As much as I'd love to talk about this grand plan that I've had for the last 10 years and everything's gone really well, it's been more of just kind of bouncing from one thing to the next and kind of where is life taking me? But it started, I was at county college, going to my community college for my associate's degree. And I saw a job ad for $15 an hour. It didn't matter what it was. I was like, oh my gosh, $15 an hour, let's do it. So I sent in my application. And then thankfully my mom was like, look, if you want this job, make sure that they know you want it. And so I sent in my resume, didn't hear anything, but then I called them, said, hi, here's where I am. I really want this job. Followed up, you know, a couple of days later. So I got the interview, I got the job, and it was for an office manager position at a small construction management firm in New Jersey. And I worked there for the summer, really liked it, liked the people there. And then I went to school for my teaching degree. But I talked to my boss. I said, look, I think I can do this full time while I'm in school. And the other office manager didn't come back. And so he said, okay, sure, give it a try. And so for the next 3 years, I worked there full time. And I worked every day with the president. And it was a 30-person company. We did, you know, $5 to $6 million a year. And I got to see firsthand how a small business works. Mm-hmm. And learned a ton from Jay being there every day with him. And thankfully, he let me take on other opportunities. So someone would leave, the marketing person, I would take over their duties. The business manager left on maternity leave. I filled in for her for a little while. I was doing business development. The accountant got busy, so I filled in for them. And so I got to see everything on the business side of a small business. And then I graduated and I had my teaching degree, but I really liked the business world. And so then I went to go work with an accountant, a small local accountant for a year, helping her. And there I got to see how dozens of small business owners work and how different industries work. And so I came from this really great business. And then I saw, oh, wait, not everybody's like that. And I also got to experience kind of some of the faults in bookkeepers and CPAs today, where they'll do the tax return or they'll do the bookkeeping, but that's as far as they'll go. And so when I was there, I started just, you know, hey, why don't you do this? Hey, I think this might work. And it started to work and business owners started to come back and ask for some more advice. And I didn't know consulting was a thing or coaching, but that's what I started to do along with the bookkeeping and other kind of accounting duties. And so we kind of grew that while I was there. An example would be, you know, there's a landscaper and he had a bookkeeper for years and was frustrated because he still never felt like he had the money he needed to. And so then I talked with him for a while and it turned out he had debts that the accountant wasn't aware of that he didn't have written down. And so we finally listed all of his debts, business and personal, put together a debt schedule for him. Hey, here's the interest rates for each one. And in a few months, we got that debt down significantly and his cash flow improved. And then we looked at his accounts receivable. That was high. We called the guys for him and we said, hey, look, you know, you're late and put in systems to prevent that from happening again. And so, you know, that's just one example of how we started taking from the bookkeeping and foundational stuff to the next level, really helping the business owner, and then into planning and things like that. And so love doing that with her there at that accounting firm, but wanted to do it on my own, had some other things I wanted to do. And so then I left her. And then for the last few years, I've been essentially doing that at my own firm with business owners.
You know, so, I love that you said a statement much earlier, and it was you got to take on versus mm-hmm. you had to. When it came to those responsibilities, I've heard a lot of people, because some of the things I do is I help some organizations hire. And so I'm interviewing people that are coming in for an office manager position, for example. And you'll hear them as you're interviewing them, they'll say something like, well, I had to do this. And then they gave me this and I had to do this. And so I had all these responsibilities. And so then I decided I was going to leave. And it's like, you know, that's right. It might be a lot of work, and it was, and plus you're going to school. So it was a ton of work, and you were taking on the jobs of multiple people, but because of your perspective, it changed everything about it, which then ultimately was a big catalyst for you and being able to be confident to open a business. So that one little attitude of I got to do it really turned into a business, which is amazing. Right. And if you didn't have that, it wouldn't happen that way. I imagine, I don't know, but I imagine.
Yeah. Thankfully, you know, my parents, both by example and then, you know, directly talking with me, always put in learning is the key. And if you keep learning, then the money will follow. And so, I got an opportunity to work at this firm, and then the owner there, Jay, allowed me to do, you know, so much more than I originally started doing. And so it was just, you know, a tremendous opportunity, and the money did follow. But you know, instead of worrying about, oh, well, I'm still making the same cash flow or cash amount, I never wanted to be saying, oh, I'm still doing the same thing that I was doing 6 months ago. And so I needed to, you know, okay, what's next? Okay, I've got that down. What's next? And so, yeah, prioritizing the learning over the, you know, W-2.
Yeah, right. So in that process, there's a lot of learning, there's a lot of growing, but there's probably some failures too. So when you think about like your biggest failure, what was that for you? And what did you learn from it?
So, you know, I don't know if I have one to point to, because, you know, on my LinkedIn, and a quote that I try to go by is, you know, I try to learn and fail daily. So I try to, you know, something that I can fail at, because it means I'm, you know, continuing to improve or get outside kind of my comfort zone. But something that I didn't do was I didn't anticipate leaving the accountant when I did. And so I was prioritizing paying down my debt as fast as possible. So I was paying off my student loans. And so I had no money really in the bank, you know, I had about $1,000, but any money that came in, it would go right towards the debt. And it was great because I paid my student loans off, which is an amazing feeling. But then I left that accountant, and for the next few months, I had zero money in the bank and zero cash flow. And so if I were to go back, I would have had an emergency fund, then started paying off the debt versus, you know, doing it the other way around, because it just would have made that transition period a lot more smooth.
Yeah. Debt is a devastating disease for a lot of people. And we're so addicted to it as a culture. We're so addicted to debt, whether it's car debt, house debt, credit card debt, student loan. It's just, we're so addicted, and it's really bad. But people that
we're addicted
are
addicted to spending, I think debt is the kind of
exactly. But people like yourself who you know, leverage the opportunity to use a loan, but then quickly take care of the debt that it creates, I think there's a lot of freedom in that, because when you're underneath, like my house right now, we owe some dollar amount that I don't need to share online, but we owe some dollar amount, and my goal is to get it paid off by 2025.
Right.
And it's a real difficult thing to do, because we moved in on December 26th of this year or last year. Right. So there's some work we need to do to pull off paying the rest of the debt, but having that target is a huge deal. That's for sure. So when you think about targets in your business and targets in your life, what is that big target? What are you really trying to achieve in your business?
So I think the target is what I've accomplished, and that is it's paying my bills. It's you know, my business is paying for my life right now, so I'm able to do what I want, and so that is great. Every day is a blessing in that sense. You know, I don't have to go punch in somewhere. You know, I'm not going to be told, hey, look, we're relocating you, or this. I have control over what I can do every day, and so to get there was a big achievement. And that's the biggest goal, and I've accomplished that. And so anything else I do is just continue to help more business owners with, you know, the bookkeeping and financial analysis and organization of their business, doing the things that they don't want to do, and really helping their business. And then the people that work with me, having them, you know, work in a really cool environment with a great energy, doing different things. And so the more I can do of that, the better. But the fact that I can decide what I want to do on a daily basis is the goal. And you know, as of right now, that, you know, I've done that. And so hopefully that can keep happening.
Well, so if you're not watching, Hurley is smiling very widely as he's making a statement about being able to have that freedom. And as a business owner myself, before we were on this episode, he and I were talking, and I said that I'm going on vacation till next Monday, and vacation starts at 3:30. And that's the end of this conversation that we're having. And for those of you that are thinking about going into business, this is a piece of the freedom that you get to. You earn it. It's hard, but you get there, and it's huge. And I love your attitude about it, because there's a piece of it that's you get that freedom, but you've also put some great people in place in your organization, and you're giving them some freedom too because of your attitude about that. How does that play out for the people that work with you? Not your clients, but the people that are working with you directly.
Yeah, you know, even when I was working at that accountant's office, we had, you know, a few other people that were working with us. And I just had the mindset of whatever we're doing for our clients, I want to make sure that the people in here also get that same treatment. And so,
nice.
You know, if I'm doing a financial plan and helping my clients become debt-free or to make more money on a business, everyone in the office should also have that. And so everyone that I'm working with, you know, hey, do you have a debt-free plan? Do you have someone that you can talk to once a month on your goals? You know, I want everybody to have a side hustle and to, you know, have something they're passionate about. You know, not everyone loves bookkeeping and going through Excel, but it's good enough to do a few hours a week. And so that's great. You know, you're helping me and my clients, but you know, what are you really passionate about? Maybe it's becoming a trainer at a gym. Well, do that 20 hours a week. You know, you have your cash flow from, you know, what you're doing with me. And then you have your passion, this other thing, and they're feeding each other. Tim Ferriss, you know, says it really well with different silos. It's important to have different silos in what you do. So when you become tired in one, you can go to the other. And so anybody who's working with me, even if you're not, you know, part of my team, but we're acquaintances or we're just connecting back and forth, you know, hey, if you want to have a conversation on whatever it is, let's do it. Or, you know, good energy, a plan, positivity, I'm here for you. So yeah, treat your, you know, your teammates the way you do your clients. You know, if you're prioritizing the client more than you're prioritizing the people who are helping with your clients, it's going to be a tough road.
Yeah. Am I trying as hard with my employee to serve him as I am to serve my clients?
Correct.
That's the question that I need to answer. That's the question that the listeners need to answer too, because if you're not, then you may not keep that employee for very long, and they're sure as heck not performing at the highest level that they could. Just yep. Like, I mean, it makes total sense. And the way you put it makes it really clear. It's simple, makes it really clear. So I appreciate that. Speaking of advice, if you were to rewind, go back to when you were a kid, let's say you're 14 years old, and you were to take who you are now, what you know now, and advise that 14-year-old kid, what would you tell him?
So, you know, it kind of touches on things we've talked about already, but I'll go a little more in detail with it, because I would have liked that, you know, when I was going through high school and then college. And so, you know, the first, like I mentioned, where I wish I had that emergency fund. And so the way I think about this is, what do I need to live every month. Not what I need to pay my kids college, not what I need to make sure my IRA is fully funded, not, you know, to go on the vacations. What do I need to live? And so that's food, that's your bills. Well, if you can't pay it, you're going to feel it. What's that number? Most people don't know that number, business owners, individuals. So find that number. We have some tools, you know, that we make available to everybody where it's helpful to find, it's really easy to find that number. Once you have that number, try to get that number as low as possible. So, you know, like you're doing with the mortgage, you know, if you have a car payment, try to pay that off. If you have credit card debt, pay that off. Whatever it is, get that number as low as possible. Maybe it's $2,000, $3,000 that you need to make a month. Then put in your emergency fund, 6 to 12 months. And if you can do those two things, you have greatly liberated yourself from needing money. And I would advise anybody who's thinking about starting a business, do those two things first. I know so many people who started the business and then they're in debt, hoping their new business will get them out of debt. What you're doing is you're putting pressure on your passion. Take the pressure off of your passion. If you do those two things, get your monthly expenses that you need to pay down as low as possible, and you've created your emergency fund, you don't need as much money every month. And so if you can already create through a side hustle, through, you know, maybe your partner has some income, maybe you have some, you know, investment money that's coming, whatever it is, if you can generate that passively, and again, if you can get that number down, it's not the most difficult thing in the world to do. Now, all of a sudden, you can give your passion the time it needs. Because if you think it's going to happen in a year, it's not. But if you can give it the time, and you can say, look, whenever this happens, it happens. I don't need this to work for me to eat next month. You're in a really good position. And if you're already a business owner and you work to get there, now you don't need to take on that client just for the money. Now you're not waking up in the middle of the night saying, man, how am I going to, you know, put food on my table for the family? That's covered. Everything you're doing is now extra. So you can focus on longer term projects. You can go away for a couple of weeks because the money isn't driving every decision every day. So that would be the you know, really concrete piece of advice.
I love what you're saying. That the way you put it so succinctly there was, don't put pressure on your passion. So I know I paused you there, but I wanted to highlight that for the listeners, because I've heard it said needy is creepy. That would be the other side of putting pressure on your passion, because you have all the pressure of the weight of needing to pay your bills, like you're talking about, and then you become creepy because you're needy to get the funding to take care of yourself. But square it away, get yourself squared away as fast as you possibly can, and side hustle the passion project.
Yep.
And then go full time once you're dialed in. And some people might completely disagree with that, right? Some people may completely disagree, but I see the logic from what you're saying for sure.
Yeah, if you're at a W-2 that you don't love, use that to fund your passion. And now all of a sudden, it's not just, man, this W-2 sucks, I don't want to go to work another day. No, you're using it to set you up for success. If you do those things, you're putting yourself in a really good position. So I would prioritize that. And it's not just, you know, people working minimum wage or $20 an hour. I have some, you know, wealthier clients, and they're spending, you know, significant amounts every month. And so they need to make that much every month. And so, you know, they're in the same position that people who don't bring as much income there, because they put themselves in that spot. So it's not so much the income level, it's what's leaving every month.
Yeah, it's the mindset of it.
Yep.
You know, choosing to see money from a different angle. And you're giving a great angle there. So yeah. What's that second piece of advice you would share with the younger version?
The quote, you know, you are the sum of the five people you hang out with the most, you're most around, is not a joke. I heard it, you know, growing up. It's so true. And I don't think I internalized it as much until, you know, I met my now wife, because, you know, I was having these amazing conversations with her every day, and I would ask her advice and get feedback. And I was like, wow, you know, I have this amazing person giving me free advice and feedback all the time. And then, you know, I kind of looked up, and, you know, my mom and dad were doing the same. I had family members doing the same. And then I put myself around really great business owners who were doing the same for me. And so I was getting free advice all the time. without paying. I was getting, you know, I was internalizing habits, internalizing, you know, learning methods just through osmosis. And so I think for anyone out there who has a goal, if you put yourself around five people who have achieved that goal, osmosis works. So, you know, if you want to be in a great relationship, put yourself, hang out with five people who are in great relationships and have been for decades. If you want to become really wealthy, be around five people who've done it. And just in the way they talk, in the way they act, in the network that they connect you to, it makes it so much easier. And so I would evaluate, you know, who are the five people you spend the most time around? If you do that analysis and you find three of them or have, you know, are in debt and have money troubles, and two of them, you know, are struggling in some other ways, maybe it's time to do, you know, kind of a good review and put yourself in a better position. So yeah, do not underestimate the five people that you spend the most time with.
Yeah, that's gold. You know, as you're saying that, I'm listening to you, but my mind can't help but go to who am I, you know, interacting with. And fortunately, I spend very intimate time with my clients in the sense that I'm asking them very deep questions and serving them in the moment. But those are the people that get to influence me at the same time. Yep. And what they don't, maybe they realize it, maybe they don't, but there's a huge benefit to me on the other end of it because of who they are as people. Right. And like you said, mentors, you had these kind of accidental mentors. And recently I reached out to the pastor at my church and I said, hey, I want to be mentored by somebody, but I need him to be great at business and to call me on my BS and to be real with me about things. And he said, I know exactly who you should work with. And he's like, this guy, Larry. And I'm like, okay, great. And then we met like several weeks later. And he's exactly the type of person that it's just a different level. You know, right. Moving you to that different level of thinking, that different level of business savvy and personal savvy. So that's great. You got another layer for us. You got another tip you would share with your younger version.
So just, you know, continue to learn and fail every day. And I think you need both. I think, you know, people here will learn every day. So, you know, people are taking classes. There's so much content online. You can watch, you can listen to this podcast. You can watch, you know, a great YouTube series. You can read a book. But if you don't act on it, and, you know, if you're acting on anything for the first time, you're going to fail, then it doesn't really mean anything. If you read a book on how to play the piano, great. You know, good for you. You haven't done much. But if you then pick it up and start playing and struggle through those first few months and then can play, you've done something. And so, you know, learn. It's easy to do, and then fail. And that, I think that's the harder part. And then you work this muscle. And so I think there's some business owners out there who are so business oriented. And so, you know, if I'm not doing something every day for my business, you know, it's not a win. You're working different muscles. And so if it is playing a musical instrument or learning how to cook or learning how to dance or, you know, some other activity, and you're working that failing and learning muscle, it will carry over to everything else you do. And so, you know, don't think, oh, I have to do something for my business today, or I have to read a business book because I'm trying to get better at business, or I have to read a, you know, accounting or, you know, whatever it is you do book because I have to get better at that. Read a good biography, read a good work of fiction, you know, try something you've never done before in some totally other genre. It will carry over. Trust me, you're working a muscle that, you know, when you do hit your field, the muscle will be ready. And so, you know, I prioritize that. I think, you know, Thomas Watson Jr. said, you know, if you want to increase your success rate, double your failure rate. And, you know, it's tough to do at first, but once you get used to it and you're no longer afraid to try different things and to, you know, kind of look, you know, a little more foolish, it's really, really helpful.
Yeah. I told one of my clients yesterday, and I said, I want you to fail four times. So it was Tuesday. So they needed to fail Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. I wanted them to find a way to fail, stretch themselves and fail for the next 4 days in a row. It could be little things, it could be huge things, it doesn't matter, but I wanted them to start thinking that way. Whether they fail four times or not is not the point. It was just to make them think every day about what can I do to push myself Because you're right, the learning comes from the failing. And what Watson, I can't remember what his first name is, but what he said is that, I love that. It's a beautiful quote because it's scary, but I think it's reality. So
yeah, it's like anything else. You know, once you continue to do it, it becomes easier. You know, thankfully, and again, this goes back to the five people, you know, thankfully my parents led by example that way. You know, my mom was in the workforce, then she, you know, stayed at home to raise five kids, which was a crazy house. And then went back to and started teaching nursery school, did that, you know, while we were still at home. And then she just went to school for her nutritionist license, got that, and is now running her own business. Awesome. And, you know, my dad has always worked multiple jobs, you know, is always, you know, what can I learn? What else can I do? And, you know, we were watching a documentary together one day, and then the next night I came over to see him, and there were three books there, postmark, hey, read this, analyze this, read this section, you can apply it to that. And so, you know, seeing that example of, hey, look, we're going to try something new, we haven't done this before, but that's what life is for, is great. And so if you're having a hard time failing every day or trying new things, find people who do it. And, you know, again, they'll kind of lead you to how it can be done.
Yeah, so true. So if people want to connect with you and learn more about what you do and how you serve businesses, what's the best way for them to connect with you?
So you can, you know, read about us on www.foxandpartners.com. That's spelled out. And then you can find me on LinkedIn.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for your time and your wisdom here, Hurley. I appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.